Hello, I'm Stephen Sachs, owner of Solutions to Results, a consultancy that helps professional service firms and organizations in the areas of communications, culture, education, and training. Today, I'm here with Nancy Fox. Nancy is the founder and president of the Business Fox, a high-performance coaching, training, and advisory company specializing in professional services businesses and executives who are seeking peak performance results. She is also the author of a book targeted on strategic business networking. It's called Network Like a Fox, a targeted approach to building successful business relationships in person and online. Thank you, Nancy, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, Steve. So glad to be with you.
So, Nancy, you use this Business Fox approach to blend psychology and strategy to guide professionals with mental fitness and tactics to produce career breakthroughs. Please provide a big picture, a perspective of what this approach is all about.
So this approach evolved over the years as I was working with many professionals who were seeking to elevate their performance and to advance their careers. They were looking for strategies. They were looking for guidance about how to do that. And I noticed something really fascinating, that they would get really great roadmaps, strategic roadmaps for how they could achieve these goals that they had. And they would be given the step-by-step roadmap for how to do it. And most of them, most of them would get tripped up. They would actually know what to do, and then they would only implement a part of it, or they would delay implementing what they knew they should be doing, or they would find reasons, they would have excuses, they would get busy. And I began to realize that this pattern wasn't an accident, that it wasn't really the reasons that they were giving me for why they weren't implementing more regularly, more intentionally, why they weren't doing it with greater acceleration is because of this. They were stuck here between their two ears. Their psychology was getting in the way of their intellect telling them what to do. The intellect, or the conscious part of the mind, is saying, you know, take action. Here's their strategy, you know what to do, you know, implement. And their subconscious mind would get in the way. Old messaging, old stories, old fears, old self-doubts would get in the way, and they would sort of be stymied by it. They would be blocked. They would be stuck. And so I began to realize that unless I worked with people on their psychology at the subconscious level, they were going to get great information, they would get great roadmaps, but they would not implement, and therefore their results could not be as good as if they really worked on the internal part of their game as well as the external part of the game. And so that's what I went to work on, to develop methodologies that would apply working on the psychological part of the subconscious part of the mind, helping people to eliminate any old blocks, any old fears, any old messages of self-doubt, imposter syndrome, fear of failure. One of my clients had a twin brother, and an old message from his parents, because he was actually the older of the two twins. His parents told him not to outshine his brother when he was a little boy. And so he wound up letting his younger brother, he never wanted to do anything that would get beyond what the result of his younger brother, but he had no idea that that's what was going on for him until we started to dig into his psychology. It was fascinating.
It is, especially when you're talking about twins.
But it happens, even if it's not twins, it could be an old message from a parent or a family member or a psychological fear about money, or fear of success, or even fear of failure. You know, it really, a lot of these stories, they start very, very young, usually mm-hmm. the ages of, you know, two to the, usually your stories get programmed in up until about the age of 6 or 7, and then they're sort of solidified. So you can be much more malleable up until 6 or 7. After that, it becomes much more, it becomes like concrete. And every year that goes by, it gets harder and harder to unravel and eradicate those old stories. When I work with people, professionals who are in their 20s and early 30s, getting to the old blocks are much easier than when I work with people who are in their 50s and 60s, because there's more years where they've been re-indoctrinating themselves over the years, which, you know, the same stories, they tell themselves the same stories over and over.
You know, in athletics, the whole idea of the mind, you know, and the role that it plays in addition to the physical speed and strength, you could see both playing major roles. But in business, you know, 95% of the game is the mind. So what are some of the mindset blocks encountered in business challenges, you know, and how influential can they be?
Well, I mentioned a couple of them. A big one, especially, well, a very, very big one is fear of failure. The fear of failure, the fear of looking stupid, the fear of looking inept, the fear of being ashamed is huge. And so people will do almost anything to avoid looking foolish or making an error, which could be a source of embarrassment. So people are terrified of being embarrassed or shame. The fear, and also fear of failure, a lot of people get early messages from family members, from teachers about that the failure is so, is to be avoided at all costs. And it's so terrible that you really got to only succeed and that you should reject any possibility of failure. So people wind up not even making attempts at expanding, growing, advancing, taking on risk, you know, trying new things. And yet those are two biggies. But also other examples will be imposter syndrome, the fear of looking like you're a fraud and that you'll be found out. And these are really, really, really common in business. Why we don't have people working on their internal game as a natural automatic training ground at the very beginning of careers is a mystery to me, but it's becoming more available and more discussed, especially in certain fields and certain industries. There are a lot of industries and companies who are paying a lot of attention to mindfulness and more attention to the psychology of success. But in sports and in performance, in music and other performance arts, it's a given that you'll work with a coach who's working with you on the psychology of your performance as well as the physical manifestation of your performance. That's automatic, but in business, no. It's like, in fact, it's, and sometimes people even think of it as a stigma to be working on them. It's completely the reverse, and it shouldn't be, because we know that we are emotional, psychological beings, and that that's where the most, it's so dominant, our thinking is so controlled by our emotions.
You and I have discussed before the conscious mind, where we've been trained primarily on logic and memory and learning and data analysis, but 95% of our thoughts are directed by the subconscious mind and only 5% by our conscious mind. So what do you actually mean by this?
Well, think about it. We spend 95% of our time and effort developing our conscious mind, learning, memorizing. We really take incredible pride at our logic and our analyses, right? We love that. We talk about it all the time. We talk about strategy, and this is all focusing on conscious thinking. So conscious thinking is controlled by the prefrontal cortex of our brains, and we spend a lot of energy and effort, and we admire that part of our mind. But the subconscious mind is working. By the way, that part of our brain is slower and is the newer part of the brain. The subconscious mind is controlled. It really is actually the more, it's the more, we call it the reptilian brain. It's older. It's the part of our brain that's functioning 24/7. And our mind is at all these thoughts are going 24/7. If we didn't have a subconscious mind, we wouldn't be able to continue breathing, or our hearts would stop beating when we're asleep, because we're not really conscious when we're asleep, but our bodies and all of our systems are on go even when we're sleeping, controlled by subconscious thinking. It's 24/7. It's a faster part of the brain. And we have about 30,000 thoughts per minute in the subconscious, and only a fraction of that in the conscious mind. So it's much faster. But the thing is, we store many more thoughts and memories in the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind, this is the key. Subconscious mind doesn't know tense. Any thought that it has, it perceives as the present. So if you have an old fear that came from when you were 5 years old and they pushed you in the pool, and you know you didn't like being thrown in the pool, and you carry that forward your whole life, your brain, your subconscious mind does not know that that was in the past. Your conscious mind tells you it's a memory, but your subconscious mind perceives it as the present. And that's why if you've ever had stage fright, is like that. If you've ever had stage fright, your brain is going to think, I'm always going to have stage fright. I'm always going to have stage fright. Until you actually teach your subconscious mind to eradicate those thoughts and replace them with preferable thoughts, you're always going to be experiencing the same thinking pattern. But the good news is that every thinking pattern, those thought patterns are basically just neurons connecting with each other. You can interrupt them and you can prune them, and you can create new ones. And the more you reinforce them, the more they become your natural way of thinking. Negative people can become positive people.
So the subconscious mind is basically where the inner game of work, career, and life is really won or lost. So if that's the case, how does the fear of failure impact our chances for success? I mean, there's different types of work cultures and interpersonal relationships, and they must have an impact on subconscious feelings.
They do. And what we tend to do about this is the exact opposite of what we need to do. So anything that you have a fear about, the more attention you give it, the more energy you give it, the more oxygen you give it, the more it's going to take over. So the more we try to resist the failure, the more we actually fear it, the more it's going to be present in our minds, and we're going to actually create it. So the thing to do is to really teach your mind to have a new perspective about any one of those thoughts. It's just a thought. It's not real. You're not failing now. You are creating a failure before it even happens. And so each time we have an experience of something, we have to realize that it's a once and done. Doesn't mean it's going to happen again in the future. We have to teach our subconscious mind and allow our conscious mind to embrace it, and then we can have control over the thinking. But most of us think that we have no control over our emotions or our feelings or our thought patterns, but we have a lot more. We have enormous power. We just have never learned to use it. We've never learned how to prune old thoughts away and create new ones. We don't know how to do that. We just think that our thoughts are our thoughts.
So without naming any names, can you provide an example or two of where a rock solid plan, which was supported by strategy and tactics, went south because the individual was stymied by his or her thoughts of failure that really won the day in that battle?
Yeah, I have a really good one, as a matter of fact. A client of mine was the head of business development for a very a major division of a major organization. And they gave him a lot. They gave him this, you know, there was a goal, there was a set of goals and everything. And what he claimed his problem was when he started working with me was he swore up and down that his problem, all he wanted to go to work on, was his time management. So I said, And right away when he said, I don't have any other issues, just time management, my antenna go up, of course, because I have to open the hood and find out what's really going on. That's my first inclination, what's really going on under the hood. So we dug around in there, and then I started to look at his to-do list, and I said, okay, what are you getting paid to do exactly? And he said, I am getting paid to bring in business from these kinds of accounts. I said, what are your second accountabilities? He says, I'm also supposed to be helping some of the professionals also. I said, which is your bigger priorities? He said, bringing in business. I said, great. We went to look at his to-do list, and his to-do list was enormous, unprioritized, and he was putting helping his colleagues at the same level of importance as bringing in those activities that related to his own business development. And I would say to him, well, why are these equal? And he, in his own mind, he was thinking he had justification. So let's go a little deeper. So then when we went a little deeper, so I just said, okay, we went a little deeper, and I started to look at his actual business development activities. And we broke them down into two categories. Some of the business development activities were lead generation, meeting new people, bringing them to the table, having them open up discussions about what was possible for them. And then part B would be actually taking those leads and turning them into closed deals. He was paying a lot of attention on lead generation. He was doing a fabulous job on lead generation. When he would get stuck in a lead generation that was dragging on and on, he would start to focus on helping his colleagues. What he was not focusing on was closing the deals. And when we dug a little deeper, what he was really afraid of was asking for the business. When we really, really dug in there, the big fear was hearing no. He didn't want to hear no. So every time he came up against, now it'd be 2-3 months into the lead generation, it was going nowhere, or it was getting close, but would go nowhere. He would then turn back to his colleagues, start helping them out. He was avoiding hearing no by helping his colleagues. He didn't have a time management problem. He had a fear of closing. He was great at lead gen, had a terror of closing. We went to work on his closing fear.
So is there some type of strategy that you can employ to prepare yourself to experience outcomes and imagine ways to reach that outcome?
Absolutely. So what we do is, first thing, we have to learn what the actual thinking patterns are that are robbing somebody of moving forward, that are holding them back. The excuses and, you know, I'm too busy. What's making you too busy? Why are you doing that? Like, and if you don't do that, what's your fear? And you start to dig and you keep asking why, you know, there's a whole process to this until you get to the root. When you get to the root, you can then deactivate that. And then you can start to use something called visualization. Visualization is used a lot in sports, where people can actually mentally create a picture in their minds, and they're teaching their brains to walk through a scenario where, for example, in this particular client, we walk through the scenario of actually asking for the final meeting for closing and going into a client meeting where he's actually visualizing moving the conversation, eliminating all the objectives, handling them one by one, having the person, the client, the potential client, nodding their heads, visualizing all of this, telling his brain to actually give him the solution for what to say when a potential client was throwing roadblocks up, so that he was preparing his brain to feed him all the right answers, to feel confident, to lower his fear factor. And when you pre-train your brain to set you up for success, you can actually, your subconscious mind doesn't know tense, it only knows the present. So when you're walking into the actual situation, it's like muscle memory except for your brain.
That must be kind of a challenge to train your brain to only, you know, have thoughts that connect with the current goals and the positive outcomes that you want to achieve.
So it's done in a process. So let's say I was giving you, let's say we would actually create a custom visualization recording for you, Steve. Like, you would have a recording, and then you would listen to it. Usually it's about 15 minutes, a recording of 10 to 15 minutes, and you listen to it for 21 days. So that your mind needs at least 21 days to eliminate one body of thinking and replace it and then have it be solidified in the mind. More than 21 days is even better, but if you consistently listen to and you go through, you literally train your mind to see it at least once a day for 21 days, it starts to become the reality.
So besides training your brain to, let's say, block negativity and allow this positivity to flow, are there any physical techniques such as controlled breathing or some other method that could also be used?
Yeah, I think, you know, people use meditation and breathing techniques as well. What I like about them, I think it really helps because a lot of times you just need to just lower the body anxiety level, and breathing will automatically do that. If you take deep breaths, your anxiety level will automatically improve. But I like a combination of things. I think you need a sort of a cocktail of ways to retrain your brain. Remember, the more your brain has been fed the same pattern of thinking, it's hardwired in your brain. You're basically deactivating an entire set of programming, clearing out the system and putting a new motherboard in, basically. That's basically what you're doing. Our brains are computers. They are neurons. They are electrical connections. Every thought is an electrical connection. So if they connect this way, then they can connect this way. You need to just teach it new ways of connecting. And breathing will be part of the process.
So who have been some of the exemplars of the power of positive thinking, or from imagining to actualizing?
In terms of the leaders in the field?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love, there are a few, the first person I started, well, I've been doing a lot of studying about this for many, many years, of course. And, you know, there've been all these books written, The Power of Positive Thinking, and all these books, even Think and Grow Rich, which is really a famous, famous book, was really probably one of the earliest books on how to really work your thinking. But we're now talking about, you know, how to use your thinking process at a very deep subconscious level. The first person that I started following about this is a neuroscientist by the name of Dr. Alex Korb. And he wrote this book called The Upward Spiral. Fascinating book. He really, he used the issue of anxiety and depression as the focal point for his body work, but it really relates a lot to way beyond anxiety and depression, but also about performance and, you know, achieving results. And then I started also learning about Dr. Joe Dispenza is fascinating. He wrote so many different books on this. He became a neuroscientist after he had a very serious bicycle accident and used his subconscious mind to heal his body. And he does a lot of work with people. He's written numerous books, and he's a fascinating guy. And then the other person that I follow is a guy who wrote I forgot his name now, Dr. Brian something. Sorry, my brain just went off. But he wrote a book called Buddha Brain. And he's another neuroscientist. So he's a really, really wonderful specialist on how to, they basically are all saying the same thing, that we have to teach our brain, our subconscious mind, what kinds of thoughts we would like to have. If you really want to have thoughts that tell you, I'm going to succeed in this project, I see myself speaking and being a success on the stage. If you teach your mind to see yourself being engaging in a conversation with potential clients, with potential students, with people who are going to hire you, or people who are going, or if you're going on a job interview, or if you're going to study for an important professional exam, people use visualization and hypnosis when they're about to study for the bar, take the bar exam, or sit for the CPA exam. So there's so many ways that this can be used. Fascinating, fascinating stuff.
Absolutely. Well, Nancy, I want to thank you for sharing your insight on a topic of concern to, I guess, not only leaders in business, but for those who are looking to ascend the ladder in their career, because, you know, there's this, it doesn't matter networking, let's say, whether you're a top leader or a person who wants to ascend and they want to be able to gain more confidence in different venues, and they have to use the mind. So when we talk about athletics, we know there's a mixture of the physical and the mental, but in the business world, it's a lot more reliance on the mental. And I think that's fascinating stuff that you share with us. And I think our audience would be most interested, particularly your references to a few of the books that you read. So I want to thank you for taking the time today. Do you have any final thoughts you'd like to share?
Yeah, I wanted to throw in one other thing that I wanted all the people that are watching and listening And that is that the visualization techniques, you know, what's really fascinating, they can be done in group setting as well as individually. They can be customized for an individual, but they are also like, if you have a, let's say you have a practice group or you have a team that's going in for making a pitch presentation, they can be done in group format. Like this kind of training can be done. It's a very quick kind of training because you only need under a half an hour to do the training. It's really, it's, you just set the goals and you can actually get people set up. It's very quick. It's very effective. They get the recording. So there's a, it's a very pragmatic way to give a really powerful tool to people in organizations and in firms to use with very, very tangible, trackable outcomes.
Well, that's terrific. Thank you for sharing that. And again, thank you for sharing your expertise with us today. And I know we'll probably look at other aspects going forward. So I look forward to chatting with you again.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. I appreciate it.